Hello everyone, welcome back to my YouTube channel Learn Life Science. Myself Vinita Tiwari and this is going to be the second part of phytohormone ethylene, in which I am going to tell you regarding the signaling process of ethylene in plants. Okay, in the previous video I have already discussed regarding ethylene, its synthesis as well as its different function with mode of action. Okay, so ethylene receptors and signaling. So first we are going to deal with the receptors that is involved in the process. So there are generally five different isoforms of ethylene receptor. Before getting into that, you should know that the ethylene process involved two component histidine system. You might be knowing about the two component system that occurs in bacteria, and the same path, process, signaling process is also followed right here. Okay, so in two component system there is a donor that is histidine. It donates its phosphate group to the receiver domain, that is our aspartate, and aspartate give it to the receiver domain, and the regulation is carried out. Okay, so I was telling that there are five different isoforms of ethylene receptors. Okay, so here ATR1 means ethylene response 1, ERS1 means ethylene response sensor, and similarly ETR2, ethylene insensitive 4, ERS2. Okay, so these are five different receptors, and the main thing is that they are localized on the endoreticmatic membrane. Okay, till now we have heard that the receptors are generally present on the plasma membrane and the ligand generally bounded on the plasma membrane, but now we know that as ethylene is a gaseous product, it diffuses very easily within this intracellular part and bound with this receptors. Okay, now different kind of domains are mentioned right here. There is presence of GAF domain, that is cGMP specific phosphodiesterase, a copper ion is a prerequisite for ethylene binding. You should always remember that if copper is absent at this receptor binding, if copper is not bound with the receptor, ethylene is not going to bind. Okay, then there is serine-threonine kinase. DHP domain means histidine phosphotransfer domain. Okay, now moving on, next list of characters. Okay, so I have enlisted the players that are involved in the signaling pathway, and this is for you to read it out. Once you get with the pathway, it will be really easy for you to learn its role. Okay, so the first character is the CTR. Okay, that is constitutive triple response 1, its full form, and it is a serine-threonine kinase. Okay, serine-threonine kinase means what? It is going to phosphorylate something. Okay, and it is a negative regulator of ethylene signaling. Okay, means what? Negative regulator means what? When it is in active form, when it is doing its phosphorylation role, it is going to make conditions off for ethylene signaling. Okay, the response will be off when CTR is in active form. Okay, the second thing is ethylene insensitive 2 or ethylene insensitive 3. Okay, the third one is the SCF E3. SCF is the skip 1 colon F box that is going to be involved in the ubiquitination process. And there are two different type of F box, one which contain ATP1-2, that is EIN2 targeting protein, and one that is F box containing EBF1 or EBF2 that targets EIN3 and EIN3, EIL1 and 2. The fourth one is the AHP transcription factor. Fifth one is ARR transcription factor. So this is what? The histidine containing phosphotransfer proteins, Arabidopsis histidine phosphotransfer, its full form, and this is Arabidopsis regulatory proteins. Okay, as they have been discovered in Arabidopsis, so they are named so. Okay, the sixth one is the RAN1, which is a copper transporter that delivers the copper to the lumen of the ER. Okay, and lastly there is presence of ENAP1, that is EIN2 nuclear associated protein 1. Now there is no need to learn all these roles. one thing you should remember regarding the, now there is no need to learn its full forms. There is one only need is you should know their role, okay, what they are doing, what they are inhibiting, what they are inducing. Okay, so moving on next. When the first condition we are considering is when the ethylene is absent, okay. In the lack of ethylene, this process is followed out. Okay, so the first thing that will happen is that the RAN is a co-transporter and it is going to transport copper from the cytosol to the luminal side, and you can see here that they bound to the receptors. Okay, now when ethylene is absent, the receptors are going to interact in a very proper manner with the CTR1. Okay, CTR1 is a serine threonine kinase, and due to receptor interaction, it is present in active form. Okay, and now it catalyzes the phosphorylation of EIN2. It is a membrane bound compound. It phosphorylates EIN2 and tag it for ubiquitination. Okay, so further role you can see here SCFE3 and F-box containing ETP1 and ETP2. What is ETP? ETP is EIN2 targeting protein. Okay, as you can see here, the phosphate group and the ubiquitin tag, and they are processed through proteasome. Okay, now the second thing that occurs is here EIN3, EL1, EIL1, EIL2 are the transcription factors that are involved in ethylene signaling. But now ethylene is absent, and therefore they are tagged to ubiquitination by SCFE3 as well as EBF1 and 2. Okay, you can see here the tag and their processing step. Now finally, there will be no ethylene stimulated transcriptional regulation. Okay, so two important thing appears here. One is EIN2 degradation through proteasome mediated by SCFE3 and ETP1 and 2, and also important role of CTR1. Okay, the second thing is the degradation of the transcription factor through SCFE3 and the F-box containing EBF1 and 2. Okay, so there are only three important things that you should remember here. Now moving on next, when ethylene is present, okay, so when ethylene is present, it bounds to the receptors that are already bound with the copper ions. Okay, so now what happens, the receptors interact equally with CTR1 and EIN2. Okay, means it interacts with EIN2 as well as the CTR1. Okay, but CTR1 here is not that much active as it was before when ethylene was absent. Okay, and therefore there is very much minimum phosphorylation of EIN2. Okay, and therefore what happens, EIN2 gets more active and now it catalyzes its process. There is an enzyme protease which catalyzes the breakdown of EIN2 into two part, that is EIN2 N terminal and EIN2 C terminal portion. The EIN2 N terminal portion role is not yet discovered. You can see here it remains bound to the membrane. Okay, and there are two important role of EIN2C. Okay, so the first role is that it binds with the mRNA that is involved in the expression of EBF1 and 2. Okay, in the previous slide we have seen that EBF1 and 2 are involved in the degradation of the transcription factor. Okay, so it is very much important to make it in degraded form, and therefore EIN2C gives a tag to EBF1 2 and get into the processing bodies. As you can see here, it functions as a tag on the mRNA and it gets processed by processing body. And the main enzyme that is present in the processing body for the degradation of EBF1 2 mRNA is the exoribonuclease. Okay, it carries out this degradation process. Okay, you should remember that the mRNA is degrading out, not the EIN2C portion. Okay, it is having more functions to do. Now the second important role is that EIN2C enters into the nucleus and binds with ENaP1. We have seen that ENaP1 is EIN2 associated, EIN2 nuclear associated protein. Okay, so it binds with ENaP1 to increase the transcription factor activity, to stabilize the transcription factor and to get the transcriptional regulation. Okay, so it is just here to regulate, to give stability to the transcription factors. Now the second thing, as we know that the receptors are in two component receptors, so histidine here is you can see there is autophosphorylation process, then the phosphate group is transferred to a receptor domain AHP phosphate. It gets into the nucleus and it transfers the phosphate group to ARR1. So the two things, ARR and these three transcription factors, are involved in this signaling process that are going to induce the expression of genes, and there will be response that is mediated in the presence of ethylene. Okay, so as I have already told you in the previous lecture on ethylene, that ethylene is always involved in the differential gene expression, which are generally involved in genes like pectinase, hydrolase, cellulase. Okay, so in further slide I am going to tell you regarding the triple response. You will see the functions or the triple response from ethylene presence. Okay, so if you are having any kind of doubt regarding the signaling process, you can comment in the comment section. Okay, now the triple response in dark grown dicot seedlings. Okay, so the triple response means the three different response are observed in plants when ethylene is exposed to dark grown seedling. The first is the root cell elongation, second one is the swelling of hypocotyl, third is the curvature of plumular hook in the seedlings exposed to ethylene. As you can see here in the picture, one is in the presence of air and second is in the presence of ethylene. Okay, you can see here the swelling of hypocotyl as well as the hooking of the plumule. Okay, plumule means the shoot area, and root elongation. Okay, now also there are some mutation cases regarding ethylene. You can see here ethylene insensitive mutants and constitutive triple response mutants. Now it is if you understood the signaling mechanism, you are easily going to understand it well. Okay, now when the receptor is mutated, when EIN2 is mutated, when the transcriptional factor EIN3 is mutated, even though ethylene is present or absent, there will be no triple response. If the receptor is mutated and still ethylene is binding to the receptor, there will be no response forward. Okay, and if CTR1 is mutated, the kinase is mutated, and even though ethylene is present and absent, there will be triple response observed. Okay, so it is in short the signaling pathway in just two sentence. Okay, so moving on next, I have enlisted some inhibitors of ethylene. So amino oxyacetic acid inhibits ACC synthase, similarly amino methoxy vinyl glycine, it also inhibits ACC synthase. Then third one is the cobalt ion that inhibits ACC oxidase. Also sometimes silver ions do this work. Then 1-methyl cyclopropane, it binds irreversibly to the receptor. Okay, so I have also mentioned a small concept regarding ACC deaminase. Okay, so a schematic model of how plant growth promoting bacteria that produce ACC deaminase and synthesize IAA by may facilitate plant growth. So what mentioned here is that till now we know that ACC is the precursor of ethylene and the process is catalyzed by ACC synthase. Okay, but as we know that ethylene is produced in stressful condition, first focus out in the picture that is given right here. When the plants are kept in environmental stress condition, ethylene tries to regulate the process, but the growth of the plant is inhibited. Okay, so what scientists do, they try something to do with the bacteria, and in the presence of stressful condition, they observe that the growth was normal. Okay, so what does the plant growth promoting bacteria actually do? The bacteria synthesize an enzyme that is 1-aminocyclopropane-1-carboxylase-deaminase. Okay, this enzyme is responsible for the cleavage of the ethylene precursor ACC into ammonia and keto butyrate. As you can see here in the bacteria, this process is carried out. Now, once ACC is degraded out, no ethylene production is going to happen. By decreasing ACC level in plants, ACC deaminase producing organisms decrease plant ethylene levels, which when present in high concentration can lead to plant growth inhibition or even death. Okay, there is a stress condition. You can see here the stress. The bacteria causes the degradation of ACC into ammonia and alpha keto butyrate. Okay, and therefore now the plant is not going to suffer from any kind of growth inhibition or even death. Okay, and due to the lack of ethylene, now the proper growth will occur, as well as the ethylene response is also going to take place even when ethylene is present in minimal concentration. Okay, so this was all about it. If you have any kind of doubt, you can mention in the comment box. If you are having any kind of suggestion to give, you can mention in the comment box. And also, if you are having something new to tell to the learners, you can mention right here in the comment box. Okay, so please don't forget to like, share and subscribe. Thank you so much.